Sabbath. We're glad for all those that are online with us to join us today. Welcome you here, air in the church and online. I got a few announcements I'd like to give. If you open up your bulletin, do you see this little flyer? This is a evangelistic series we are going to have, and those online, there is a little key box here for those that have a phone to look at it, and this will lead you to the site to be registered. We are going to start March 25th at 7 p.m. here at the church. But in order to do this series, we're going to need volunteers. We're going to need lots of volunteers. We're going to need people that can register here in-house, greeters that come to the door, ushers that will usher people in. We're going to need parking lot attendants, people that can park people. We're going to need hostesses because we said that we would have food, crackers, and what was it, cheese, and other sweets that we would have. So we're going to have hosts. We got our teachers, but we're going to need some other aides that will help our teachers in the youth division. We're going to need Bible facilitators because we're going to have Bible studies after this. And we definitely need a prayer team. We're going to be praying for these people during the service. So if you look at your bulletins, you'll see another sheet here. It has over 200 names. These are of our Bible interest for the last 2.5 years. These are also Bible students that are doing Bible studies right now. And they are also some of our missing members. So please take that home and pray. And when we have our series, we need to be praying during that time. Also, another thing, we have lots of ministries in this church, and we're going to have a nominating committee this year too. And every leader that's in these positions, some may want to be replaced, some may not. So in order to share with you, we've been doing a Bible study for 2.5 years. I've been doing it from my home. It's now moved to the church so the church can see what a Bible school is and what it does and the hours that you have to go into it. So I'm going to ask people every Sabbath, I have to have Bible helpers to help me do this. At home, this could take me 2 to 5 hours a week. So I need helpers that are willing to cut my time down here to less than an hour if you have 3 or 4 people helping. This is reaching the community and surrounding areas. So I just want to keep that in mind. Did you have something? And then I'll have a few more announcements. Jenny?
Good morning, everyone. Good Sabbath. I just wanted to remind you not to forget about Religious Liberty, the Liberty magazine, your sponsorships. We need those as soon as possible now, and if there's any changes in your sponsorships or if there's someone you're not sponsoring, we'll need to know that too, so let me know. And we need the your sponsorship income turned in by the end of the month, so please remember that. Then we had a baptism couple of weeks ago, and so we need the membership vote for the church for Felix Annan. Is Felix here?
Yeah.
Okay, so Felix was baptized and he knows the principles and our beliefs, and we're asking for a vote of his membership this morning.
I nominate we accept Felix as a member of our church.
There a second? Good. Okay, discussion. All in favor of the right hand of faith? Amen. We also have a membership transfer. We're honoring the board moved Thursday night to honor the request of Joshua Anderson to the Crowley, Texas Church. So this is the first reading for Joshua. That's all I have.
So if anybody is looking, Heather and Dan left today for their vacation, but she has a friend that moved from another state to here, and they're buying all new appliances. So if anybody needs a washer, dryer, stove, refrigerator, or microwave, come see me and I'll give you her name and number. So if you're interested in anything like that. I have something here to read. This is from coming from Christian Service. It's about the Holy Spirit. Christ has promised the gift of the Holy Spirit to his church, and the promise belongs to us as much as to the first disciples. But let every other promise, it is given on condition. There are many who believe and profess to claim the Lord's promise. They talk about Christ, about the Holy Spirit, yet they receive no benefit. They do not surrender the soul to be guided and controlled by the divine agency. We cannot use the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is to use us. Through the Spirit, God works in his people and to will and to do his good pleasure. But many will not submit to this. They want to manage themselves. This is why they do not receive the heavenly gift. Only to those who wait humbly upon God, who watch for his guidance and grace, is the Spirit given. The power of God waits their demand and reception. This promised blessing claimed by faith brings all other blessings in the train. It is given according to the riches and grace of Christ, and he is ready to supply every soul according to the capacity it has received. So I pray, Lord, help us to really understand that we need the power of the Holy Spirit daily and surrender our lives to him so that he can work through us. At this time, we'll start our service.
Our opening hymn today is number 2 in your hymnal, number 2.
Let us bow our heads. Father God, we want to praise you. It's a beautiful hymn, and we've sang it many times. But Lord, help us to bring our hearts today, that we can praise you because you are the Creator. You are our Redeemer. You're the one who made us and saved us, and ultimately, you're the one who knows us better than we know ourselves. So God, we come here today to find truth, to be changed, to be made new, to give our hearts over to you, and also to support our brothers and sisters who are also on this journey. God, we praise you for all that you've done, and we ask your presence to fill this place and to fill our hearts as well. In your holy name, everyone said,
Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Good morning, church family, and to those of you online as well. Okay, I ask that as I read today that you bring your tithes and offerings up front, please. And our tithes and offerings are going to the Adventist World and Radio. The Adventist World and Radio is a media ministry of the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventist, with more than 1,000 worldwide radio stations and local studios, cell phone, evangelism apps, podcast, health messages, and internet-based outreach. Adventist World Radio is reaching nearly the world with the gospel. Radio is still the primary source of communication for most of the world. It knows no borders, no walls, and no limits. It can penetrate homes and hearts and go where missionaries cannot enter. Our major target of Adventist World Radio broadcast is the 1040 window comprised of parts of North Africa, the Middle East, and Asia areas currently closed to the gospel message, but easily reached by radio. Last year, Adventist World Radio's Unlocking Bible Prophecies and Earth's Final Countdown series received millions of views in dozens of languages. Many of these videos still have top results when people reach for Bible prophecy topics on YouTube and Google. For every day, Adventist World Radio receives messages from around the world. One recent letter said, "The Unlocking Bible Prophecy series is transforming my family. I was raised Baptist and attended church on Sunday, so I've been so blessed to learn of the Sabbath and will be attending my first in-person Adventist church service this weekend. Today's offering is for the Adventist World Radio, which has been broadcasting the good news to the world for more than 50 years. Currently, Adventist World Radio broadcasts in more than 100 different languages, but plans are underway to prepare evangelistic sermons and health presentations in more than 500 languages and dialects so that every person on the planet can listen to the Bible-based message in their own language. Thank you for your prayers. Partnering with the Adventist World Radio is the greatest calling ever." Thank you.
any of the kids out there? Okay, a couple, maybe some of you guys have heard this book before. Okay, maybe some of you have heard this book before. In the beginning, God created everything else. Then God created Adam and Eve. Perfect people in a perfect world. The only thing God asked of Adam and Eve was that they not eat the fruit from a special tree. So they didn't. And all the people of all the world lived happily ever after, forever and ever. The end. Okay, so Adam and Eve messed up. Satan tricked them and they ate the fruit that God told them not to eat. That is when they first sinned. Sin is when we do something that we know God does not want us to do. Oops. Years later, a whole bunch of people lived on the earth. The people wouldn't quit sinning. So God told a man named Noah to build a giant boat called an ark. All the people of the world got on Noah's ark. Then God made it rain. In rain, it was so boring on the ark that the people learned their lesson and never sinned again. That's right. God told Noah to put two of every kind of animal inside the ark. Then Noah and his family went inside. Only Noah, his family, and the animals were saved from the great flood. One day, a man named Moses was busy tending sheep. Just then, a mailman appeared with a letter from God. "Special delivery for," the mailman said, "a letter for Mr. Moses." In the letter, God explained that he couldn't remember Moses' phone number, so he had to write Moses his special message. God really spoke to Moses as a voice coming from a burning bush. God told Moses to go and lead God's people out of Egypt. Goliath was an angry, mean giant who hated God's people. Goliath challenged anyone of them to fight him, but they were all too afraid. Then a very brave boy named David, who had been chosen by God, came forward to fight the giant Goliath. Goliath rode with laughter. When he saw David, but as David came closer, Goliath thought he knew him. The giant put on his giant glasses so that he could see David a little better. Hey, Goliath shouted. "Aren't you David, the son of Jesse, the one anointed by God? Can I have your autograph? Let's be friends."
Noah,
That's not what the Bible says. No, Goliath never wanted to be friends with David. In fact, Goliath was so mean and hated God's people so much that he wanted to make them his slaves. But David took a smooth stone, put it in his sling, and killed the giant God had used David to save his people. That would be the last one. Any of you want to come up and pray? Dear Jesus, thank you for this day. Hope that the Sabbath goes well. Hope that it's a beautiful day today and we have a good time with food, with friends and family today, and hope the food to nourish our bodies. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our first song will be number 483 for our song service, I Need Thee Every Hour.
Every morning, every morning. faithfulness, O Lord. Great is thy faithfulness. As we gather, may your Spirit work within us. As we gather, may we glorify your name, knowing well that as our hearts begin to worship, we'll be blessed because we came. We'll be blessed because we came.
Our next song is 350. Blessed be the tie that binds.
Share our praises and our prayer concerns. And they had a cancellation this week at the dental office, and so they called and asked if my husband wanted to ask me if my husband wanted to take that one. And so I said, yes, we'll take that. Of course, he didn't really want to go this soon, but he did. And he had a really good dental report. He only had one small cavity, and the dentist said that his teeth looked very good. They were good and strong. So, shocking. I know. I mean, it's been 24, 25 years since. Go figure. Okay. Mary? Mary?
Praise the Lord. The spot that Sherry had a cancer on, so it went down from 3 centimeters down to 1 centimeter. And she's got 3 more chemos to take. And then the bad news is, Lord, her biological mother died this morning.
Okay. We'll pray for her. And Mary Beth.
I need prayers for my dear friend Julie Schreiber, and she's my bass player, Matt. She had a heart attack Thursday while she was
alive.
She's only like 52.
Oh dear.
And this is her third heart attack.
Wow. And she's so young. Cheryl?
The young man that we prayed for last week, not yesterday, was the Christensen family. It's no relation.
Okay. Todd?
That's what I keep before us, just so that as you guys see the chart still up there in front of our computer. There's still things that need to be probably done, some work on the floor just to make sure it doesn't get deteriorated through blood, water, stuff like that. And so I want to continue to lift that up so that our past members are always about those things that are necessary to get us from point A to point B.
Okay. Felix? Okay. Lorraine.
Praise God. Let my niece be able to share home yesterday. My nephew's still home with his vehicle, but he's doing much better. Hopefully,
it's good to see you, Lorraine. We're so glad you're back. We missed you big time. Anyone else? Okay. I'll bring my sister before you. She's been having some problems. She lives in Clear Lake at the One Vision program. And she had a good review, annual review, but the drawback was she's pretty negative on her volunteer work. She wants to cut that out and not do any more volunteer work. And I told my brother, well, that's what was keeping her uplifted before. And he said, well, she has one good thing in her life right now, and that's the pizza and praise on Tuesday nights. So I don't know how much of the praise or the spiritual she's absorbing, but she likes the pizza, so. Yes, amen. Anyone else? Pastor Josh?
Yeah, we mentioned, I think, but the Evangelism 6 series that's coming up, especially the people who God wants to come here, their hearts will be open, and they'll learn about Jesus.
Okay. Todd?
I just want to say this. I mean, sometimes I work where you take things for granted, and my world got turned upside down a little bit. The guy that I work with is no longer with my partner, and so I'm running solo now. And thank God that God has kind of given me a work schedule that is conducive to my, let's see, what's the word I want to say? My comfort zone, let's put it that way.
Oh, okay. Amen. Anyone else? Okay, if not, those of us who are able to pray or to kneel, let's do that. Our loving Father in heaven, we're thankful to be in your house this morning. We come before you with praise and singing. Lord, we love to sing. We love to sing your praises and your words, your hymns. And Lord, we're thankful for the Sabbath. We're thankful for new members and members who are contemplating membership, and we also thank you for the member who's transferring, Lord. We love them all. And Lord, we thank you that you work in our lives to will and to do our good pleasure. We need that. And we ask that you forgive us where we've fallen down, because we need you to pick us up. Help us not to object to that, or to be negative, or to try to go our own way, because we can't do it. We can't do it without you. We thank you for the Sabbath school we enjoyed, for the things we're learning in Hebrews. It's all about you, Lord. It's just all about you. And it's amazing, and it's miraculous, the miracles that we're seeing. Lord, help our eyes to be open to see the miracles around us, because we know that they're there every day. Lord, we ask that you bless the tithes and offerings that were brought before your altar this morning. We ask that you multiply them, bless them to your glory and honor, and for the needs that's there. We pray that we can reach many people with the offerings that we give. And we thank you for cheerful givers, Lord. We thank you for all the names raised up this morning. And we want to pray for each and every one. And Lord, we pray for the people in Ukraine. It's a crisis. We pray for President Zelensky. We pray for President Biden. And we pray for President Putin's heart. We don't understand what's going on with him, and we don't understand the reason for this crisis, but Lord, help us to stay faithful with our prayers and whatever else we can do to help. And we are so glad that Lorraine's back with us, Lord. She's feeling better. We're so glad to see her, and we pray for her and for Jamie and Carter. We're thankful that Jamie was released to come home, and Lord, we pray. We're thankful for them and for Carter's continuing to improve. We pray for his healing. We pray for all the medical team that's serving him. And Lord, we pray for Heather and Dan on their vacation. We pray you'll keep them safe. We pray for their travel mercies. And I thank you for Dan's good dental report. And Lord, we thank you for Sherry's good news too, that the cancer has gone down and only 3 more chemo sessions. We pray, Lord, that you'll be with her through those, and we pray for a complete full recovery for her. And we pray for Lori's biological mom that passed away. We pray for her and the family. We pray for their grieving, that you'll be close to them and put your hand of peace upon each one. And we also pray for Mary Beth's friend, Julie. Lord, she's had a third heart attack, and she's only 52. So, Lord, we pray for her healing. We pray for your hand of peace upon her. We pray for her family. And we pray that she gives all glory to you. Lord, we pray also for the fundraising for the Pathfinder trailer. And we pray that they'll be able to use it a whole lot when the weather clears. We pray for the events that they have scheduled and planned. We pray for our Pathfinders and Adventurers. Pray for their hearts to be turned towards you, and that they learn much about you through these clubs. And we pray for Miranda's friend, Charlie. We pray for the complications that she's suffering in her pregnancy. We pray you'll be with her. And Lord, we pray for my sister, Johnita. Pray for all that's going on in her life. Pray for my brother. He's always there for her. And also my sister, Cindy. And Lord, we pray for our evangelistic meetings coming up. We pray for volunteers. We pray for we pray that our technical equipment will work and no breakdowns. And we pray for hearts to be open to receiving the message. We pray for Cami open as she brings these messages to us. Lord, we pray for every part of the meetings. We pray for the lessons, the content, the biblical studies. We pray for the question and answer period after. We pray for the follow-up studies. We pray that we can all be a part of this and help us to lead souls to you, that they can know you and have that relationship with you to sustain them. Lord, we thank you for Todd's good news about his work. He's working solo now in his job. And if it's conducive to his comfort zone, Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you for all the blessings that you bring into our lives. We thank you for all of our families, friends, coworkers, all the peoples in our lives. Lord, I pray for that one person this last week at the dental office who was quite nervous and anxious. I'm thankful that the receptionist was able to calm her. And Lord, I told her that I'm praying for her. I don't know who she was, don't know her name, but I pray for her, for peace that she needs from you and her relationship with you. Lord, we all have those people in our lives who were not raised up this morning, and we take a quiet time right now to pray for them. We thank you, Lord, that you hear our prayers. Thank you for all the people that you bring into our lives on a daily basis. Thank you for leading us and guiding us. We thank you for your words. We thank you for the Lord Jesus. And Lord, we thank you for our speaker this morning. We pray for Pastor Josh and the words that you've laid on his heart to share with us. Help us to absorb those words, Lord, and to ingest them and to share them, because they're important. They're your words. Help us, Lord, to get a blessing because we're here and because we put our hearts into this. We pray for Pastor Josh and Myra, and we pray for all of our church family. And we thank you for them. And we pray in the name of Christ Jesus, our dear Savior, our Redeemer, our mighty Counselor, a wonderful Lord, and our very, very best friend. Amen.
Everything to your control. yours and yours alone, completely.
Just like to point out that I'm married to one of those people. That was very beautiful. You both sounded amazing. Praise the Lord for music. Amen?
Amen.
Man, that was beautiful. They tuned the piano and it just sounds, ooh, it's really, praise the Lord for music. Before we begin, I'd like to start with prayer. Father God, I want to thank you so much that we can all come together. God, we are free and we have many blessings. Each of us is on a journey to follow you, Lord, and help us, as the song said, to trust you, to make you ours completely. And more importantly, that we can be yours, Lord, that you can work in us and through us and change us and make us the men and women that we know we're called to be, that we know our friends and families need. Lord, help us to grow day by day with you. Lord, may this message bless you and bless your people. In your holy name, everyone said, amen. So today we're going to talk about our mission. Now, a couple weeks ago, we talked about God's mission, right? God's mission was to build relationship with his people, to make the ladder from heaven to earth, to connect to his people, to reach out, to save, to lift up. Amen. We even mentioned how part of that might be for us, that we need to fix that breach. Fix that foundation. Now, if you're just coming in today, some of that might not make sense, but you'll have to watch it on YouTube. We got it on YouTube. But today we're going to be talking about our mission, and just like God's mission, if you look through the Bible, there is a lot discussed about what my mission is, or more importantly, what our mission is as a group. So I had to make some choices, and well, it turns out I had a pretty good guide for my choice. In fact, as a church, well, this isn't on, so that's not going to work. That was my fault. It's not on. As a church, we decided to write a mission, but I wanted to tell you a story. So I was a missionary in Peru when I was 17 years old. Now, this was before I knew Spanish. It was before, in fact, I was one of those people. I grew up in Eastern Oregon. It's a predominantly white culture, very American. Like, if you watch an old Western movie, that is Eastern Oregon. But now they wear, like, baseball hats and they have chewing tobacco. But other than that, it's the same thing. Right, you're in this, it's a Western movie, that's Eastern Oregon. So not a lot of different cultures, right? So I went to the Amazon completely unprepared for what I was about to experience. It is a totally incredible experience. And one day we woke up at 5 a.m. and we got in some boats and we went down the river on the Amazon. And I don't know if you know this, but the Amazon has what are literally pink dolphins. There are pink dolphins in the Amazon because they eat the red algae, which literally makes their skin pink. It's incredible. Now imagine this, one of those picturesque, it's almost like a calendar, one of those picturesque moments where you're sitting, it's 5:30 a.m, the sun is just rising over the horizon, there are literal monkeys in the trees and pink dolphins jumping in the water, right? Now this was a very guided experience. There was a leader missionary who was taking us down the road and down the river, and he had with him locals who had lived there their whole life. The Amazon is not a safe place. In fact, there are parts of the Amazon that they have still not researched and discovered. There are still people groups there who do not know about
civilization hardly. Their main experience is like shoot arrows at them and run away. Like that is how far. If you go down to the Amazon, you're in dangerous territory. And in fact, like 3 or 4 miles, the guy said that there was a group of tribes that when they were in times of war would turn cannibalistic, because it was the greatest way to truly defeat your enemy was to devour them, right? And so I thought, wow, but I ignored that. I was seeing all this beauty. I saw how wonderful it was. And you know what I decided to do later? I said, wow, that was such a beautiful experience. I want to go explore the Amazon. So I'm 17. I don't know Spanish. And we're on this, like, they have to build their huts on sticks, right? Because the Amazon ebbs and flows. And so they kind of just build it in the water a little bit on sticks. And we were in this big building. I decided to leave the building. I go out, maybe 100 yards, and I'm looking at all these trees. And if you've seen the pictures of the trees in the Amazon, they are incredible. They're from me to Nora. The roots. What happens is this huge tree, but then the roots, like, they come out like wings almost off the tree, and they just go and go and go and go above the ground. So I was like, what I would do is I would see a big tree. Wow, that's amazing. And then I'd look over, there was another big tree, and I'd wander off farther, right? And then, wow, 17-year-old me, really thinking this through. And then I saw another one, and before I knew it, I did that about 3 or 4 times. Before I knew it, I had no idea where I was. Zero idea. As lost can be. I just saw a bunch of trees, and now this is a large forest, right? I mean, Iowa has nothing on this. The forest just goes up like 10 stories, and you're just, I mean, it's dark almost because there's so many leaves. It's like dark down there. I was terrified. Now, praise the Lord, one of the girls in our camp they were playing, and one of the guys was flirting with them because they're in high school, and she did that little scream that girls do, that, ah, like, don't tickle me, man. And it was so loud that, praise the Lord, I heard it just barely off in the distance, and I ran that direction, and I survived. Praise the Lord. I would not be here today otherwise, probably. If you're in the Amazon, if you get a mile off of your camp, you're probably going to die. I mean, especially a 17-year-old who is clueless, which I was. So now here's the problem. I didn't know where I was, and I didn't know where I needed to go. If it wasn't for that scream, I would have died. But what happened is that girl screamed. My very good ears heard the sound in the distance, and it said, X marks the spot. That's where you need to go. All of a sudden, I knew where I was because I knew where I needed to go. Do you see that? If you're lost in the woods, but all of a sudden you see a mountain that you recognize, you know where you are now. Does that make sense? So we as a church want to serve Jesus, and we want to serve him effectively, and we want to serve him as a body. Amen? We want to join God in his mission, which is what we talked about 2 weeks ago. God has a mission, and if I call myself a Christian, which is little Christ ones, one who follows Jesus, if I say I'm a Christian, then I should live my life according to his mission. Is that reasonable? So God's mission, from that flows our mission as a body. Because we are a church, and a church worships God, which means they need to do what God does. Is that fair? Okay, so I need to move forward. A mission statement. We decided as a board, the leaders of the church, to have a mission statement. And I want to talk about why. If you Google why a company or a business needs a mission statement, this is what it says. Mission statements help members see the meaning and purpose of their work by giving them clear reasons their job benefits a larger goal. So if I know that our church is for XYZ, then when I get down to the details of my daily life, I know how to live to support those goals. So me as the pastor, for example, I know that I need to do certain things because as the pastor of this church, I want to support the goals that this church has, right? Since I know the goals, I know where I need to spend my time, right? Pathfinders, same thing. The Pathfinders knows the goals of the church and what God is trying to do in this community. So then the leaders of Pathfinders can pray about it and ask God for guidance according to that goal. Is that fair? Okay, so that's where we start off. We have a mission statement because I need to know what God wants our church to, where's the X on the map? Where are we trying to get to so that I know where I am now and how to move forward towards that goal? That's why we needed a mission statement. And we as a church board spent a lot of time thinking about this. And as the pastor, I came up with three questions that if we answer these three questions, we should be able to discern from God's word and from the Holy Spirit what his mission is for this church. And that was the goal. So the questions are, what are the main strengths in this church that God applauds? So let's say, for example, I think this church is very family-centered. Biblically, that is clearly a good thing, right? The Bible lifts up the family over and over and over again. So we study that and we said, wow, that is a concept that we as a church have already been blessed with. So I'm going to talk more about this in a couple weeks, but you need to use the gifts God has given you, not the ones he hasn't. Yeah? So there are people in this church that are really good with numbers, for example. Don, for example, is our treasurer, right? You're probably a lot better at numbers than I am. So if I said, you know what, I can do that, and I just try to push Don out and I do that job, is that going to be good for the church? Definitely not. There's going to be a lot of bills that get missed. I'm just saying. Yeah, she might do, right? So you use the gifts that you actually have, not the ones that you wish you had. So the first question is, what gifts, what things has God blessed us with that we actually have? Second one, what is God's goal in planting this church in Waterloo? Right? Waterloo isn't every city. A lot of Christians get, a lot of churches struggle because they try to do the entire world church's mission and they ignore basically their local area. And that's a problem because Waterloo has issues that Seattle doesn't have. And if I try to fix Seattle's problems in Waterloo, I'm reaching no one. Unless I just get lucky, right? If you try to fix Seattle's problems in Waterloo, you're not helping. And if you try to fix Waterloo's problems in Seattle, you're not going to help. So we need to know why we're here. What does the fact that we are Adventists do to strengthen our mission? So we're not just a church. We're an Adventist church. We're an Adventist church because we believe there are doctrines, there are pillars of our faith that are important, and that those things help Christians be strong in their walk with Jesus. Yes? That's why we're Adventist and we're not Methodist or Baptist or, and those, there's a lot of true Christians in those churches. Don't get me wrong. What I'm saying is we exist as a mission for a reason because we believe there are certain truths that people need to know. And we're going to talk about some of those today. Right? Like the imagery of Jesus' life. If you have any idea of the Bible, I think you're going to see these concepts. He was discipled, i.e. he knew his Father and followed him daily. So the first step of a church that wants to disciple people is they need to actually be following Jesus. Right? There's a lot of people who go out there and they want to tell the world how wrong they are, but they don't spend time learning from God. Let me put it this way. Jesus himself, who was the Son of God, who was born connected to the Father and never sinned, still spent hours daily in prayer. Which is why his mission was so perfect, right? Why he was so effective. He got from the Father. He said, I don't speak of my own accord. I speak what the Father says to me. Yes? That Jesus himself told us that. So how much more a broken human, a broken organization consisting of broken humans, how much more do we need to make sure that we individually are following our Father? That we actually listen to him. That we actually know what he has to say. That in the morning when I try to make decisions, I say, Lord, is this your will for my life? And I promise you, if you go through that process in your daily life, he will answer you. Ask, and you what? Shall receive. Seek, and you will. Knock, and the door will be opened. We don't have because we don't ask. If you don't know any idea, if you have no idea what God's will is for your life, it's not because he doesn't want to tell you. God wants to tell you. And I'm not saying it's simple. I don't want to turn it into just something trivial. It's a heart-wrenching thing. You pour yourself out before God. But when you do that, he will listen to you. And then when you start walking, you're going to have purpose and meaning and confidence. Jesus says, I give you peace that the world does not give. Because when I'm just wandering aimlessly, there's no peace in that. There's no meaning in that. There's no purpose. No, but when I listen and I follow Jesus, man, there's strength there. Number two, he spent time with his disciples in daily life. Jesus, I was researching this and I couldn't find a strong figure, but Jesus walked at least 3,200 miles with his disciples while he was in the 3.5-year ministry. The guy was walking with them all the time. There's something about discipling that means I come alongside them, that I'm actually in a journey, in a process with them. So we as a church, what we want to do is find people who want to go on a journey towards Jesus and walk with them there. When they trip, we help them get up. When they get off to the side, we say, hey, no, come back this direction to Jesus, right? It's easy to get distracted in this world. We need support. That's what we're here for. Number three, he understood their culture and used that to teach lessons. The world now, this is actually more important today than it was then, because the world is changing so fast. Let me put it this way. The difference between, Jenny, you and I are of different generations, yes? Okay, the difference between my generation and your generation is pretty noticeable, right? But I can guarantee, as far as the culture, the presuppositions, the things we've gone through, but I can guarantee you, the difference between my culture and someone who's 40 years younger than me is going to be much bigger. That difference is going to be much bigger than this difference. Because the rate of change in culture is faster. Do you see what I'm saying? In fact, there are almost no longer, I was doing research on this, it's really hard for scientists to even find a generational statement. Millennials are from this year to this year, more or less. Right? Gen X, this year to this year. But now the generations are changing, it's like every 5 years almost. You have to, because the things they've gone through, the technology they have, the presuppositions, the wars we happen to be in at the time, the safety of going out in the street, everything is changing so fast. What that means is, if you want to come alongside someone who's 30 years younger than you, if you want to come alongside someone who's 30 years older than you, you need to understand where they're coming from. And that's only going to get harder. Jesus spent time talking about crops and fishing and plants and fruit because that's where the people lived in that day. Right? He knew their culture. So the church's mission statement goes on. It says, discipling people in God's love and end time message. Look, like I said, we have a message in this church that is powerful. And if you don't understand it, I'm telling you it will change your life. There is depth to this, the prophecies, the understanding of God's plan, the great controversy. We're going to go through a few of those right now. Now, I had to pick and choose, right? Because there's a lot of truths that our church focuses on. But number one is Jesus' sacrifice for us. That is the end time message. Now, there's other things that go with that, and I'm going to cover those. But look at this, Revelation 14, which, by the way, if you don't know, that's kind of it's kind of the text that covers the things we focus on as a church. Categorically speaking. The very first thing it says, then I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting, what? Gospel, the good news that Jesus died and resurrected for us. Amen? So we got to start there. Jesus sacrificed for us. Then beyond that, we're going to get there, guys, I believe. There we go, the great controversy. A lot of churches have the idea of, like, Satan is evil, God is good. But when I ask the question, why did God allow for sin? If you don't know the great controversy, you don't have an answer. Why are we not in heaven now? Jesus died 2,000 years ago. Why are we not done? Why does God allow this to do you see the question? If you don't know the great controversy, you don't have an answer to that question. The Bible does have answers. But those answers cut deep into how we live and how we're spending our time. People don't want to know them. But I can tell you, if you know the truth about this, that God has a plan, that he is showing the world his character of love, and that takes time. Really quick, let's say Myra says, Josh, you're mean and you aren't a good husband. So in order to fix the problem, I just divorce her. Have I solved the question of whether I'm a good husband or not? No. How do I solve that question? I love her. I live opposite to what she's saying. Satan said that God's kingdom and that his way of ruling was selfish and prideful and arrogant and that he wasn't worthy of ruling. So God's process is to show first that he is a good God. Jesus came and died and showed his love and that goodness can be revealed in his people. That God can change hearts and minds and lives, which is what we're doing now, by the way. I could go more into that, but the Sabbath. Revelation 14:7, worship him who made this heaven, the earth, the sea, and the springs of water. That is literally a quote from the reason we keep the Sabbath in Exodus. The first time the Ten Commandments are given, this is a quote of that, right? Revelation 4:7 is quoting the fourth commandment, to follow God and to worship him. The Sabbath is that I mentioned this before, the Sabbath is the thing that connects the big God of Genesis 1 to the personal God who forms man out of the dust of the ground and breathes into him the breath of life. If you don't have a time where God says, I want to spend time with you, I am your creator, I am your savior, and I want you to come to me. If that is forgotten, then we forget that God is not only big, but he knows you and he loves you and he cares for you. And that big, powerful God knows you enough to save you. That is the message of the Sabbath, that I don't need to work because God has worked for me. I don't need to save myself because God saved me from Egypt. He saved me from my sin. That's the message of the Sabbath. That's why we don't do those things, not because we just want to sit there and not, I don't want to do those things. I'm special. That's not the point. The point is I get to rest. I get to trust God. I get to remember that he's my creator and my savior. Praise the Lord. That truth, I can tell you, I've been to Sunday churches. That's what I grew up in. And they don't even keep their own Sabbath. It's constantly going. Why do you think American culture is the way it is? Constantly going, constantly working, constantly trying to get more, trying to fulfill yourself, trying to make your... Because they don't stop. They don't just stop and trust the Lord who gave everything for them. But praise God. Praise God, he knew that we would need to rest, that we need to take that time. There is beauty in the Sabbath of a God who wants you and knows you. He is not here. Praise the Lord. Death and resurrection. Now, this isn't just that Jesus resurrected, but that you and I are going to resurrect. And not only that you and I are going to resurrect, but that that resurrection is dependent on God giving us life. One way we often talk about this as a church is the state of the dead, right? What happens when someone dies? And I'm just going to give you an image that I abhor. Imagine there's a God who has to give life to keep people alive. When those people die, they either go to heaven or hell, and if they go to hell, God keeps giving them energy, giving them life, so that they can keep living. Meanwhile, he is torturing them, and that is somehow revealing his love. That's the message that evangelicals are spreading across the United States. And I think they are sincere in their desire to show God's justice. But they miss that justice and love are not opposite of each other. A God of love does not torture people for millennia for 70 years of sin. That is insane. And there are verses that are a little confusing of why they believe that. I'm not going to argue that. All right? But I'll just give you really quick. It says forever and ever or completely or eternally. That word just means totality, right? If something burns completely, it's not still burning, is it? It stops burning. That's being burned completely. When I die, I'm not still alive, dead. I'm actually dead, right? So we can talk about those things, and I don't want to justify it, but this whole thing about the great controversy and showing God's character is that he's not the kind of God who would do that. And I think that theology is responsible for the vast majority of atheists. Because honestly, if that's the only option you have, probably not a God worth worshiping. I think a lot of atheists are in the right because they haven't heard the truth of the Bible. All they've heard of a God who burns people eternally because they sinned for 20 years. I wouldn't follow that God either. But praise the Lord, that's not what the Bible teaches. There is hope. Amen? Christ's ministry in the heavenly sanctuary. Therefore, in all things, he had to be made like his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make propitiation for the sins of his people. Man, that's a lot of big words, but the idea is that when Jesus died, he went up to heaven, and he's connecting us to the Father. He's there listening to us. When I pray, Jesus hears my prayer. And this is a quote that I think is well said, so I'm using it. The sanctuary message opened to view a complete system of truth, connected and harmonious. And we're not crazy when we use this. Revelation is full of imagery of the priest, right? So that's kind of the end of the sanctuary system, right? There's a priest who goes in and he cleanses the sanctuary. But that same imagery isn't only in Revelation. That imagery is from John the Baptist. Behold the what of God? The Lamb of God who takes away the what? Sins of the world. That's what the Lamb did in the sanctuary system. The sanctuary system helps us see that God's process, this great controversy that is going through history, God has a plan. And as this process moves forward, it reveals God's character, shows his goodness, and eventually the sin will be taken and it will be put on the scapegoat, and that scapegoat will go and disappear and sin will be done. Praise the Lord. Nobody said amen. Sin will be done. Amen. I'm going to say it again. Sin will be done. Amen. Wow. Thank you very much. Look, sin is horrible. Sin is destructive. Sin ruins your life and your family's life. Sin is not good. And it's crazy I have to say that. God doesn't want us to sin because it hurts us. And praise the Lord, the sanctuary system shows us that eventually, at the end of time, and I think that time is coming near, that thing, sin itself, done. The rebellion over. And then finally, as Revelation points out, we will be with God forever. There will be no more crying or pain or tears. And the sanctuary system is how we know that that makes sense. Move forward. Move forward. Move forward. There we go. Church mission statement. Discipling people in God's love and end time message, empowered by the Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord. Empowered by the Holy Spirit. This is what it says. Here in Acts 2. Now we know Acts 2, right? The New Testament church, this awesome church, right? Praise the Lord for that church. Listen to what they did. Men and brethren, what shall we do? These are people who are non-Christians. They're asking, what do we do? I don't know. I want to be saved, but I don't know how. This is what Peter said to them. Repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is to you and to your children and to all who are afar off, as many as the Lord our God will call. Praise the Lord that it's for everyone who's far off, because by the way, all of us are those people. Right? We're not Israelites. We're not in Israel. We're not even close. Here we are. But praise the Lord. Repent. Baptized, filled. There's a first step that happens where God convicts you of your sin, right? He lets you know that you are sinful. And when that happens, you say, I don't want this, because like I just mentioned, sin is destructive and painful and horrible. I want to turn away from this, and I want to turn to something better. And I am baptized as a sign to the world that I want to follow Jesus. And when that happens, I am filled with God's Holy Spirit. That means my heart, my life, my mind are being changed by God's truths. It's coming inside of me. It's changing who I actually am. A lot of Christians who focus on like saying that there's no more law, we don't need to follow God's ways, and I disagree with them, but I disagree in a more important way. If I just say that I don't need to follow God's ways, does that mean that it's okay to lie, cheat, and steal, and murder, and have adultery? Is that okay? Obviously not. But there's a fear that if I try to go against those things, I can't because I am a broken man. But Paul says in Romans, praise be to Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, right? I can be changed. Who shall save me from this body of death? Jesus Christ. He gives us the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, which comes inside of us and strengthens us. Now, I'm not saying it's something that, like, you wake up one day and you say, I want to follow Jesus, and you turn over in bed, and now you're like a perfect human, and now there's no more sin in you. That's not how it works. Because, interestingly enough, when Jesus saves Josh, he saves Josh. He doesn't save Josh fake version with a lobotomy and now I'm just like a robot and I just do what God says. The past of who I was is still there. And that old man, Paul says, right? That old man is always knocking at the door trying to become Lord of my life again. And I'm constantly having to say, no, Jesus, I want Jesus, no, old man, I want Jesus to be the Lord of my life. There is this process, and eventually, Jesus' rulership becomes stronger in my life, and that old man gets behind, farther and farther behind bars, until finally he's dead, and I am following Jesus in heaven, because this corruptible must put on incorruptibility. There will be a day at the second coming when even my want to sin, my tendency, this human body that lusts and hungers and needs and selfish and scared and fearful, that's going to be... Because I've given my whole self over to God. My heart is turned over to Him, and Jesus has rulership of my life through the power of the Holy Spirit. He promised He would send it. When people say, you need to change your life, you're missing the point. You need to give yourself to Jesus, and that'll change your life. Amen? Praise the Lord. Church's mission statement. Discipling people in God's love and end time message empowered by the Holy Spirit to strengthen families in faith and relation with each other. Now, if you were an atheist, and you didn't care about God, and you didn't care about the truth, and you saw that last, that dark part, Do we want to strengthen families in faith and relation with each other? Does that sound like a good thing? Sounds like a good thing to me. In fact, if you're an atheist, you want your country to be successful so you can be richer and you can be powerful and you can be more comfortable and safer, etc. The best way to do that, statistically speaking, is to have a strong family unit. But the only way you're really going to do that is either by fear or by faith. And fear doesn't last very long. Let's move forward. So first, we strengthen the families. How do we do that? This is an amazing statistic, and there are numbers that change a little bit. Sometimes it's 1 out of 900, sometimes it's 1 out of 1,000, sometimes it's 1 out of 1,500, but it's like less than a tenth of a percent. 1 out of 1,105 will divorce if they go to church together and either read scripture together or pray together as a couple on a regular, ongoing basis. 1 out of 1,000 will divorce if they are consistently together searching after God's will. Isn't that amazing? And I just want to disabuse your mind of a couple of statistics. The idea that 1 in 2 people divorce, right? 1 in 2 marriages divorce. But what skews the statistics is that some people get married 5 times. And after in your first marriage, it's actually it's only 27%. And after your second one, it's like 56%. By the time you're at your fourth marriage, it's like 95% you're going to get divorced. Right? Because as it turns out, if you can't love one wife, you're probably not going to love the next one either. Now, I don't mean to be harsh. There are exceptions to every rule, okay? So please, you know, your situation might be different. But I'm just saying, if it's my problem, which often it's at least 50% chance it's my problem, and probably more if it's me. Like if me and Myra ever get divorced, which we won't, but if we were, it would definitely be me. I'm just saying. And if I wasn't able to love Myra, which is an amazing, wonderful person, I just spit on you, I'm sorry. If she's a very patient woman. If I'm not able to love this amazing woman, the chances are that 5 years later when I remarry, it's going to be me, my problems again. So I just wanted to disabuse your mind of that. When you get married, there's not a 50% chance you're going to get divorced. There's a 27% chance, and that's if you're not even a Christian, right? But if you're following Jesus and you're in prayer, what happens, it's amazing. When my wife and I pray together, she opens up her heart to God, and I open up my heart to God, and over time our hearts become one, and I'm actually listening to her, and I'm understanding her, and there's this safety when you're in God's presence that creates a unity that you just don't get otherwise. And God's word, by the way, informs our minds and helps us be on the same path. Right? When we're reading a text and it says, do this or that, or live this way, or trust God in this area, I say, wow, I'm not trusting God in that area. And my wife can be like, you're right. Or she can be like, you're right, and I'm going to help you. I'm going to support you, which is, by the way, what my wife always does, right? So praying, 1,105. 1 out of 1,105 are going to divorce. The other 1,104 are going to stay together. And I pray that happily, right? So strengthen families in faith and relation with each other. This is simple. Love God and love people. You need to strengthen families in faith in their connection to God and in people. I mentioned this in Sabbath school, but since we're talking about marriages, if the people you're closest to are also the people you're meanest to, if the people you're closest to are also the people that you're meanest to or least Christ-like with, probably the niceness that you're sharing to the rest of the world is not real. I'm going to say that again. If your family, the people you're closest to, are also the ones you're the meanest to, probably the niceness that you're showing to the rest of the world is fake. It's a facade. It's to protect you, but it's not who you are. Because the people who know you but most should love you the best. If that's the case, then you're successful. Because they know your heart. They know you want to love them. They know you're changing, you're growing, you're sincere. But if there's this like double life happening, guarantee you the public one isn't the real one. Guaranteed. I've never seen an exception to that rule. Our mission? This is the mission of the Waterloo Seventh-day Adventist Church. Discipling people in God's love and end-time message, empowered by the Holy Spirit to strengthen families in faith and relation with each other. Praise the Lord. Isn't that beautiful? There is so much packed into that statement. I love it. So, as we look at that, how are you involved in your church? How are you involved in your community? How are you involved in your family? When you look at this mission, is the Spirit of God changing you and changing how you're involved? Look, Paul has mentioned it probably, I don't know, Paul, what, 60 times that we're having the evangelistic series? How many people have offered to help? A few. So let's say it's five, and there are 50 members in this church that come on different Sabbaths, 10%, maybe. I gotta say, I haven't specifically gone up to him and said, hey, how can I help? How are you involved in the church, right? We have a mission here. There is a mission here, and we are changing the world. And it is slow, and it is a process, and it is hard sometimes, I can guarantee that. But we wanna do it together by God's love. How are you involved in your community? A good question is, like, if this church disappeared tomorrow, would our neighbors notice? Would the lady at Casey's notice that this church ceased to exist? Or the house that's next to Casey's? I don't know. I don't know the answer to that question. But if you want to see that change, the truth is you have to be the change you want to see. You can't just say, the church needs, by the way, my whole generation, that's all we say. The church needs to change while they're like way worse and not doing anything for anyone, right? It's like, no, it's hard to fight that because that's a normal urge. But if you want to see the change, you can be the change because God promised to give you the Holy Spirit. He promised. There's no question. He's going to work in your life. Amen? And I know I'm belaboring this, but I just, man, are you involved in your family? Once again, if the people you're closest to are also the people you're the meanest to, you are not a sincere Christian, probably. Or if that's true and you're changing, then maybe, you know, there's a process of change, you know, of course. But do you see what I'm saying? All right. So, as we think about the mission of the church, it is this. Discipling people in God's love. And end time message. Empowered by the Holy Spirit to strengthen families in relation with God and with each other. Amen? So let's pray for that together. Father God, I want to thank you so much that you know our needs and you know our hearts. And at the end of the day, our church wants to reach the world. There is a mission. There is a field of people who don't know about your love, God. And I honestly struggle to know how to help. So Lord, guide us. Help us to work together. Help us to grow in faith. Help us to go home and know you more and love you more. Lord, please work because God, we need you. Help us to be at peace. Because God, you are working. Help us to hear your voice. In your holy name, amen.
To sing How Great Is Our God. Please stand with us as we sing.
The splendor of wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great is our God! Sing with me, how great is our God! And all will see how great. He stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end, the God has. Godhead three in one. Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? Oh, we'll see how great, how great is our God. And you're the name.
Let us bow our heads. Father God, thank you so much that you are great. Lord, help us to lift our hearts to you, and we want to go on a mission for you. We want to follow you, Lord, but sometimes we don't know where to go. We don't do things your way, and it's hard. But God, we lift ourselves up to you because you are great. You are good. You are the name above every other name. And at the name of Jesus Christ, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. Lord, we confess today that you are our God. Amen. You are our Savior, and we trust you. In your holy name, everyone said,
amen.
Amen.
We'd like to thank everyone for joining us today and those online also. We ask you now to greet one another and join us in fellowship in the fellowship room for our meal. Thank you.